Cop Talk on KUGN. Crime stats,
prevention tips,
criminal hotspots, and more on Cop Talk.
It is 7:40 on the second Monday of the month. That means it's now time for a very special edition of Cop Talk.
With Chief Pete Kearns in studio with us, as he is each and every second Monday of the month. Good morning, Chief. Thanks for being here.
Good morning. You're such a good crew. It's good to be here.
Oh, thanks.
Chief, plenty of things to talk about this morning. Let's get things started with a new grant that the Eugene Police Department has just received.
Yeah, we've renewed our DUII grant again this year. It's about $28,000 from the state for high visibility enforcement. And the reason that this grant is renewed is because we know that persistent enforcement of DUII laws reduces fatal crashes. And boy, we've had some tragedies in our community over the years. And we've been fairly aggressive with this in the last few years. And we've seen a reduction in fatalities related to DUII driving.
It really does seem that over the years we've had more and more DUII enforcements, and you keep adding more and more, and I think that's a really positive thing for our community.
It has been, and you know, Mothers Against Drunk Drivers is a fantastic organization that supports this kind of effort. It's a group of people who have lost loved ones, often their own children, to drunk drivers, and it's a great way for all of us to remember how critical this kind of work is.
You also have some really, really good officers on the patrols. Ryan Stone is one that we've had in studio before, and is he still heading that?
Ryan Stone is. He's moved over to the Springfield Police Department, and he is an outstanding officer. I was very sorry to lose him. Springfield's lucky to have him. And we have a great cadre of police officers who stepped right in and are continuing that work.
So with this grant, Chief Kearns, what does the money go towards specifically?
It goes towards the officers working extra time during the key hours when people are most likely to drive while intoxicated.
So another issue near and dear to the police department is the mental health issues and some of the people that you work together with when it comes to that.
Yeah, the United States really has a growing homeless population, and often the people who are homeless, the ones that we encounter the most, I should say, are people with mental health conditions. And it's not only homeless. We go to the homes of people who suffer from severe mental health conditions, who frequently call 911 or call other service providers and who need our help. And what we've experienced here is pretty common in a lot of communities, and that is when someone is in mental health crisis on the street, police officer will contact them, and sometimes they need to be arrested for their behavior, or CAHOOTS will contact them. They'll be taken to the emergency room, or they'll be treated by the Johnson unit. Sometimes they end up in jail, and the problem is that we have these brief encounters with them. They briefly, while in custody or in the Johnson unit, will be treated and get their condition under control. They'll be released, and they'll almost immediately devolve into the way they were before they were contacted by us, and we'll do this cyclical thing over and over and over with them. It's not healthy for them. It's really a problem of funding and coordination. And so one of our municipal court judges, Judge Mary Morey, has been bringing together all these different organizations, including police and EMS and CAHOOTS and Lane County Behavioral Health, to try and find a solution to the handful of people who intensely need so much help from us.
When an officer responds to somebody with mental health issues, Chief, how does the procedure change?
Well, many years ago, about a decade ago, Memphis Police Department found that there was an increase in their use of force related to people with mental health conditions. Mm-hmm. And so they developed a new training program that's been used widely across the country. We require every one of our officers to attend crisis intervention training that's based on this Memphis model. A lot of departments in Oregon use the same program. And so our officers, when they show up on scene, they do a pretty good job of evaluating the condition of the person that they're encountering there and de-escalating their behavior and helping them in the best way we can. So the work that our officers perform on the street is really superior, but it's that integration, that coordination between agencies and services that we need to find a way to improve on.
And how often are mental health issues combined with drug issues?
Well, often people who are homeless have alcohol or drug addiction because of their mental health condition. So it's almost always a co-occurring incident.
The Buckley House is one that you've that you work with closely as well, and that was in danger of being shut down a couple of years ago, I believe. How are they doing?
Very well. You know, when there's the risk of losing a key service like that, sometimes something even better comes out of it. And the Buckley House has been pretty innovative. Representative Nancy Nathanson worked in the legislature last year to acquire some funds for the Buckley House that have been used in a pilot program that helps transition people that we take in who are too intoxicated to care for themselves and ensures that they transition from that sobering place in the Buckley House to detox and hopefully to treatment. And it's been a pretty effective program. At least that's what we see anecdotally, and we'll see what the data says over time.
It's a special edition of Cop Talk with Eugene Police Chief Pete Kearns. And Chief, last we spoke, you were in the process of hiring some new officers. What's the latest?
The latest is that we had about 240 applicants. 220 of them are able to move forward. So that's a good sizable pool. It's not the largest. It's not the smallest. But we're hopeful. And then here in January, we'll start a new process and see how many applicants we get from that. And then our plan is that the highest competing candidates from the two processes will move forward and be hired. So it looks very promising.
Any idea how many officers in total you would like to hire?
Well, we have about 12 or 13 vacancies right now, so at least that many. It's usually good if we can overhire a little bit, knowing that there will be retirements and people moving on for other reasons down the road.
And in the hiring process and then the training process as well, law enforcement and community relations is really high, and it's a peak story right now all around the country. But how do you deal with it here in Eugene?
You know, the events that have happened around the country recently have really brought to light the concerns that many in police, in the police profession and in the community have about police-community relations. People of color, different ethnicities, and gender tend to feel often as though they're treated differently by police. And unfortunately, law enforcement has very unfortunate moments in our history that support those fears. And so here in our department, we recognize that every human has implicit biases that our subconscious beliefs and stereotypes that we often aren't aware of, and even the most well-intended people will have implicit biases that affect their decision-making. So we have training that has that at its core that was developed by the Simon Wiesenthal Center in Los Angeles that's used by a lot of police departments. And we require, of course, that all our officers go through this Perspectives on Profiling training. I think a lot of agencies are recognizing that we need to think differently about our role in society and see ourselves less as warriors that are occupying our communities to make them safe and more as guardians that are present in order to help the people that we serve. And I think that change in posture and the development of a lot of new training that emphasizes empathy in every contact and in our policies and our practices will help to improve the relations that police have with their communities.
Chief, I'm curious in the process. So, you know, obviously Ferguson, New York, Cleveland, Milwaukee, different instances with police. After something like that occurs, do you call your officers in yourself and meet with them individually? Do you meet as a team? How does that work?
We do have conversations internally about it. We have in-service training every month, and when there is something notable that's happened around the country, I will comment on it. But more importantly, my job is to think carefully about our training programs and our policies to ensure that they are carefully engineered to ensure that we're providing services in a way that's going to be supportive of our community, increase trust with police, and provide the very best service possible.
If you're just joining us, this is a very special edition of Cop Talk. Every second Monday of the month, we have Police Chief Pete Kearns in studio. And if you missed it, DUII grant funding. EPD is the recipient of 28,800 DUI high visibility enforcement overtime grant dollars. So that is really exciting. Now, before we let you go, Chief, we want to talk about those three very important days coming up where the enforcement will be in high visibility.
Yeah, drunk driving does go up on Christmas, New Year's Eve, Labor Day, those types of events. So a lot of this funding will go towards enforcement on those days. I know most people are very careful to not drink and drive, particularly on those days, but on any weekend, any day of the week. But sadly, there are enough people out there that take that risk and put all of us in danger. So on those 3 days, we'll have a particularly high emphasis on DUII enforcement.
Very good.
He is the chief of police in Eugene, Chief Pete Kearns. Chief, as always, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Have a great week and a great holiday.